So good evening, everyone. My name is Dr. Tarang Kulkarni. I'm a consultant here at Jupiter Hospital in the Department of Pulmonary Medicine. So on behalf of our department, I would like to invite you today to this exciting academic meeting on connective tissue disease, ILD. To start things off, I'd like to invite Dr. Alpa Dalal, who's head of the department in the Department of Pulmonology here in Jupiter Hospital. So she'll start things off. Ma'am.
Good evening, everyone. I welcome all of you for this academic feast that we are going to have. It's actually a kind of celebration. Our department just got the DNB accreditation. So what better way to celebrate the academic feast, academic achievement than by doing academic feast? Because nowadays all other parties are off. So we just thought that we should have an academic party. All of us are trying to now come back to our clinical practice, non-COVID clinical practice. So I think it's a good way to reconnect with our non-COVID academics and non-COVID skills. So this is the topic that we selected for CHEST Forum. It's on interstitial lung diseases. So all of us have been seeing more and more cases of interstitial lung disease of varying etiology. And since in our department now, new people have joined in. So we thought that new blood with new knowledge, with recent advances and skills should be aligned with the seniors practicing with their wisdom and real life case management. So aligning both this, the experience and wisdom with the new knowledge and new skills, we thought of starting this CHEST Forum. So this CHEST Forum is going to be now regularly conducted every month. We will have this CHEST Forum on second Saturday of every month, the same timing, 5 to 6:30. The first topic today is on interstitial lung disease. Next time, we will be having on severe asthma. So I think without much ado, I will just give over to Tarang and we'll start off with the sessions. And thank you once again, all of you, for showing this enthusiasm and joining in with us today. The sessions are going to be interactive. We would have case discussions along with panel discussion, interactive discussion, and a theory discussion of recent advances. So thank you, all of you. Over to Tarang.
Thank you, ma'am, for that wonderful introduction. So the first topic for today is the pulmonologist approach towards connective tissue, towards ILD. And Dr. Manas Menger, who is a consultant here at Jupiter Hospital, is going to start. Dr. Manas has done his DM from Safdarjung Hospital and Vardhavan Mahavir Medical College in Delhi and has recently joined our department as a full-time consultant. So Dr. Manas, if you can start, please.
Thanks a lot for your time, and I wish all of you and your families are in great health. So we will start here with a quick review of approach to ILD. We will have an overview of clinical presentation and checklist of the things we should be taking care while taking the history of the patient and examining him. We should not miss them, a pragmatic diagnostic approach, how to monitor and follow up the patient, and gross overview of the management of ILDs. So, ILDs, they have the heterogeneous group of diseases, so many diseases, clubbed in the single group. Why? Because this has some similarities. This has some common clinical, physiological, radiological, and pathological manifestations. Now, the term DPLT has been synonymously used with this, with the realization that it is not only the interstitium, but also the airways which are involved in the different diseases to different extent. It involves the processes by which the normal lung parenchyma is replaced by the replaced by varying degrees of inflammation and fibrosis. So, you know, in the past years, ILD has been associated with a lot of nihilism and taken up with a pessimistic approach. But now, with the involvement, you know, ever-evolving technology being harnessed in the medical science, medical research, we are able to decode the disease pathways and we have a better molecular understanding of the disease now. This has definitely helped us in changing and improving our diagnostic approach and management of the disease. Just a second, there is some interruption. Sorry for the technical difficulties. Okay. So Now, so we are in a much better position to face this problem. So first step, what is the need for diagnosis? Yes, there is a need. Because it's more than a group of 100 diseases. They have a different clinical course. They have different response of treatment. So as a clinician, if I want to salvage my patient, just like, you know, like example, if I recognize and prevent the exposure in HP or smoking cessation in RV, ILD and DIP, I could actually reverse the disease. Or if I cannot do that, at least I can provide clinical stability and good disease control. Or in case of progressing fibrosing ILDs, at least I could provide a good, you know, palliative care, progression-free survival, and improved quality of life. Down.
Dr. Manas, you can just start presenting from the current slide. That will make it easier for you.
Yeah, that's what I'm doing.
No, it's not presented.
Are you able to see it?
Yeah, we can see it very clearly. Just go to the from the current slide, you start. Yeah, press that. Niche one. Yeah. Now it's easier.
Stop moving. Yeah. Okay. Don't do this, it's not moving it. Okay, now it's better. Sorry. Okay, so we return back to the slides. So we start with the classification. Okay, so first thing, first point of the classification is the things we know of. DPLD of known cause, example, drugs or associated ILDs, like CTD-associated ILDs or exposure-associated. Next is things which we don't know of, idiopathic interstitial pneumonias. So they are either non-familial or familial, mostly non-familial, and they have been classified depending on the clinical presentation as chronic fibrosing, IPF, and idiopathic NSIP. Note, it's idiopathic NSIP, not NSIP. Acute and subacute fibrosing, cryptogenic organizing pneumonia, acute interstitial pneumonia, and smoking-related, RVILD and DIP. Then we have a group of granulomatous ILDs, like example, sarcoidosis, and some rare forms, LAM, PLCH, and pleuroparenchymal fibrillosis. So what are most common signs and symptoms of ILDs, most common clinical presentation? So answer is, it is non-specific. So, you know, it will be, I won't do justice with the clinical presentation if I just enlist the symptoms, 1, 2, 3, 4. So we will just, you know, take a snap of case scenarios. A 56-year-old female comes to our OPD, and she's complaining of chronic cough, chronic dry cough since last 1 year. Thorough clinical examination, thorough history taking reveals nothing except for respiratory system examination, which shows bilateral infrascapular and inspiratory clefts. Chest X-ray shows bilateral lower zone infiltrates, reticular linear interlacing opacities. CT suggestive of NSIP pattern. So finally, we got the diagnosis of MCTD associated NSIP ILD. So MCTD presenting with ILD and no other systemic features. This is one of the tricky cases, 74-year-old male, known case of diabetes, hypertension, IHD, EF is just 30%. He just underwent CAB, his wounds are fresh, recovering from surgery. He presents with 4-day history of fever, cough, and rapidly progressive dyspnea, and CT showing bilateral diffuse GGOs. What is the first thing which is going to click your minds? It's heart failure, infective etiology. Patient was optimally being treated for the both. Still, his oxygenation gradually went on worsening. Bronchoscopy was done, which thoroughly evaluated and ruled out all possible infections, including the atypical panel. Now, what saved the day was a good history taking, which revealed that patient had recently shifted to a new house after surgery, which was closed for a long time, and recent cleaning and painting was done there. And bronchoscopy was supportive, BAL revealed lymphocytosis of more than 25%. So diagnosis of possible HSP, hypersensitivity pneumonitis, acute HSP was made, and patient was started with steroids. Responded very well to it. At follow-up, patient is off oxygen, and at 6 weeks follow-up, and activity level is significantly improved. Next, we have 48-year-old female, 7 months history of chest pain and dyspnea on exertion. And she came with a 2D echo record of severe PH. Only thing we could see was hyperpigmented macules over skin of both forearm and slightly thickened. CT suggestive of bilateral diffuse scattered nodular opacity, central lobular distribution, AN rate was high, centromere pattern, diagnosis of sclerotoma. So presenting mainly as PH. So clinical history, main points, dyspnea and cough, usually chronic and gradually progressive, cough is usually dry. Constitution symptoms of fever, weight loss, and tiredness, they are commonly associated mainly with the CTD ILDs, pleuritic chest pain in serositis like SLE and RA. Patient might present as a DAH in cases of pulmonary renal syndromes and ANCA-associated vasculitis. Signs of pulmonary hypertension, signs and symptoms, pedal edema, exertional discomfort, syncopal events can be there along with the symptoms of ILD. Now, these are the points which I want to typically stress on. We should never forget. These are the questions we are going to ask the patient if he doesn't tell. Smoking history, why it is important, risk factors for progression of CTD ILD. It is associated with IPF, DIP, RBILD, and Langerhans histiocytosis. Occupational history, we can get the exhaustive list over the internet. We can keep it in our OPD. We can make a checklist of it. And we should never forget. And most important, environmental history to rule out hypersensitive pneumonitis. Why I'm stressing it on? Let's see the next slide. You see this? This is the ILD registry of India. So 47.3% cases of ILD are HSP, hypersensitive pneumonitis. So every 1 in 2 patients we see in our OPD of ILD, very high chance that he is a case of hypersensitive pneumonitis. And CTD ILD and IPF, they are the distant runners up. What about friends? Okay, varied presentations. So this is the medication history. Again, we should get the list. I have just list over the internet, and I have just listed a few common medications. Methotrexate in RA, I'm sure not, it's a very dear drug to our rheumatologist colleagues and they won't agree to it. And amiodarone associated arrhythmias. So previously it was thought it's mainly related to the dose, dose of 400 mg for 2 to 3 months. But, recent studies have refuted that. So even at the lower dose, patient can present with amiodarone associated ILD, interstitial pneumonias. So temporal association is the most important point. We should try to take the good history. Physical examination, hold the hand of your patient, check for clubbing, check for saturation, check for BP, hypertension at early age, think of scleroderma, lupus nephritis, apart from other things, obviously. Respiratory system will reveal patient is tachypneic, rhythm is regular, it's a shallow breath. And auscultation, favorite bilateral, bivasilar Velcro caps, although this sub is not accepted now. These can be heard in organizing pneumonia, sarcoidosis, HP and bronchiolitis, where airway involvement is there. And also look for the signs of pulmonary hypertension and cord pulmonary. So head to toe examination for clinical signs and stigmas of CTD. Dr. Rahish, who is a rheumatologist, will be telling about this in more details in the coming talk. And I'm just enlisting the points. Ask and look for the alopecia, look at the face of the patient, look for the rash, malar rash, heliotrope rash, look for the ulcers in the mouth, look into the eyes of patient, are they angry? Think of rheumatoid arthritis or sarcoidosis. Look for the hearing loss if you are suspecting vasculitis. Again, hold the hands of your patient. Look for the skin thickening, swollen figures, and papules. And do they look like mechanic? Look for the arthralgias and arthritis diagnosis. So these are the two types. Like in diagnosis, we can expect two types of tests. One which are going to help us in making the diagnosis, and another are for the functional assessment. So we'll start with the chest X-ray. It can be normal in 10% cases. Rules out alternate diagnosis. Normal in, narrows down subtype of ILD, like lower zone, upper zone predominant. Increase or preserved lung volumes, like in case of OAD. These things, they are not important single. It's better if we, evaluate chest X-rays in trend. They are more informative if radiological investigations can be evaluated in the trend. We have the previous CT, previous X-rays. Now we go to CT. CT has to be done as per the ILD protocols. I'm not going to mention that. It's a different topic. So two most important things in CT are location and other is the pattern. So upper zone, we all know this, sarcoid, silicosis, cold worker pneumoconiosis, hypersensitive pneumonitis. Lower zone, UIP, NSIP, CTD ILDs, asbestosis, DIP. The ones which have peripheral reticular are IPF and NSIP, nodular sarcoidosis, berylosis, HSP, again a list, ground glass, NSIP, a big list, cryptogenic organizing pneumonia, infections, alveolar hemorrhage, pulmonary edema, sarcoidosis, cystic, LAM, LCH, pneumocystis, etc. So, you know, we have been commonly coming across the terms UIP, NSIP, RBILD, DIP. So basically, what are these? Are they radiological pattern? No. They are the histological, histopathological findings. And they have a very classic, you can call it a signature on their chest CT, which is very consistent with them. So if I am getting a histopathological finding of UIP, I am going to get a very consistent pattern on the CT scan more than 95% of times. These are the functional assessment tests. Spirometry, obviously, it usually reveals restrictive defect, obstructive in case of those with airway involvement. Lung volumes, they are shrunken, decreased tidal volume, and total lung capacity, common finding. Reduced single bed DLCO, corrected for hemoglobin. This might be normal in the early disease. If there is a disproportion, if I am seeing that lung volumes are normal and there is significant reduction in the DLCO, think of pulmonary hypertension. Then 6-minute walk test. This is an excellent test. You know, hardly, you know, doesn't involve any cost. Measures functional impairment, desaturation of more than 4%, and reduced distance. They are useful in prognosis and monitoring follow. Now, ABGs. ABGs mainly are indicated for people with saturation of less than 90%. So we can club ABGs along with this test. So advantages. So when I want to assess my patient, when I want to see how much damage is there, I need numbers. These tests are going to provide me with number. Objective assessment tool, diagnosis and prognostication of ILD, NSS functional impairment, disease progression, and response to treatment. And just like, you know, you need a good technician and it involves some cost. So these are the serological investigations which have to be done in any case of ILD. So CBC, urine analysis, ALP, BUN. Now you will ask me, you know, only this much. So, you know, after thorough clinical examination, if I am suspecting, then we can add disease-focused investigation. Suppose I am suspecting vasculitis, I can add ANCA to it. But these are the basic tests which are to be done in any case of suspected ILD at the first presentation. Now, what is the role of bronchoscopy? Don't underestimate the power of a well-conducted bronchoalveolar lavage. You know why? Two reasons. One, it supports a diagnosis. And second, it can be diagnostic. Supporting lymphocytosis more than 25%. Okay, clinically, radiologically correlate. Again, sarcoidosis, HSP, cellular NSIP, drug reaction, LIP possibility, more than 50%. Further narrows down, HP and cellular NSIP, eosinophilic pneumonias, yes. Neutrophil more than 50%, shows acute lung injury, aspiration pneumonia, suppurative infections. So BAL, it can be diagnostic in the following conditions. CD1A positive, more than 5%, Burbank granulin macrophages, yes, it's PLCH. Milky fluid and pars positive stain, alveolar proteinosis. Progressive bloody return in the sequential lavages. It's DH. Similarly, berylosis in positive lymphocyte transformation and lipoid pneumonia. It helps in narrowing down diagnosis. This is TBLV. Diagnostic yield is quite varied, 25 to 86%. Only 20 to 30% in IPF. Bad case. You know, IPF is a bad case for it. 80 to 90% for non-fibrotic. So these are the cases. So, you know, one study has shown that we can get adequate specimen of up to 77.6%. So in 3 in 4, we can get adequate specimen, but definitive diagnosis is only 1 out of 3, 36%. So TBLV has to be chosen for the diseases which are peribronchovascular distribution or centrilobular distribution. They have the complications of bleeding 1 to 4%, pneumothorax 1 to 6%, mortality of less than 0.05. So should not be an indefinite UIP pattern, you know that. Now, TBLC, this is again catheter-based newer techniques. It uses Joule-Thomson effect, you know, freeze and thaw. We can get a good sample. This is what it is made for. But it has failed to convince pulmonologists for its safety. But about diagnostic accuracy, see, I have mentioned about diagnostic yield is around 83% against VATS, which is gold standard, which is 92%. Sensitivity is 87% versus 91% of VATS, 57% specificity versus 58% of VATS. So it's quite close to VATS. And, you know, problem is we need to choose the patient. FVC should be more than 1.5, FEV1 more than 0.8, and DLCO more than 30%. And see, look at the complications. So pneumothorax, every 1 in 3 patients can have moderate to severe bleeding, that is 0 to 78%. Acute exacerbation death, yeah, death can be in up to 4.3 patients, and it requires GA. So VATS is the gold standard. Again, it will require FVC of more than 55. This is just summarizing all. So here, TBLC, transbronchial cryobiopsy, wins the game. It can take the best piece, 20 mm square. Architecture is well preserved, but maybe complications are not acceptable. We need time to confirm it. So most important thing, still, you know, we land up in the scenario very frequently where still we are not able to conclude in spite of good history taking and thorough evaluation. Here comes the role of multidisciplinary discussion. So it is specifically useful in the initial diagnostic and reducing number of patients with undifferentiated allergies in cases with atypical findings. And you know, a lot of studies have been conducted, and it has been found that MDD helps in improving prognosis, changing management, reduction in number of the unclassifiable ILDs, changing initial diagnosis, higher confidence in the diagnosis, and should be performed in patients with the inconsistent findings. Now, who should be part of MDD? Definitely a pulmonologist, because I am the one, clinician, any clinician, and a radiologist, for sure. Rheumatologist, yeah, in case of CDD ILD, and pathologist if biopsy is involved in the discussion. Monitoring. Let's make it simple. The current Indian guidelines say that every 6 months, we are supposed to do the functional assessment test, FVC, DLCO, 6-minute walk test, HRCT at the baseline, and then at the, you know, not necessarily every year. We can repeat an HRCT if it's indicated at our at clinician's discretion. So if I'm suspecting embolism, if I'm suspecting infection, or maybe exacerbation. So only then it's required. So if a patient is not able to, you know, perform this test, then there is Medical Research Council Dyspnea score. We can download it from net and we can do it. FVC decline of more than 10% is a at 6 month assessment is a marker of you know, poor prognostic marker of mortality. Similarly, DLCO more than 15% is a marker of mortality, and more than 50% decline in the 6 minute walk distance over 24 weeks has 3 times. Increase in the mortality over 1 week. So role in CTD could be confounded by the joint pains, and even in PS, the same. IPF, they advise the frequent monitoring at the interval of 4 to 6 months. This is the diagnostic algorithm we just discussed, cough and dyspnea, X-ray, bilateral infiltrates, we do a PFT, we do all the functional tests, 6-minute walk test, we do a CT. CT may, if there is a definite UIP or if there is a proven ILD with some pattern on the CT, we don't need a biopsy. In case the distribution of disease is peribronchovascular or centrilobular, we can go for, you can, you know, use bronchoscope and the catheter guided interventions. If inconclusive, VATS is the gold standard, VATS guided biopsy. Treatment, removal from exposures, immunosuppressive therapy, antiferro. We will just discuss these points. So a thorough history taking is required. For removal of exposure, drug, environmental, occupational, look for the temporal association with them. For occupational, we may advise patient to change the occupation. The role of steroids and immunosuppressants. We should definitely, you know one thing, that role of immunosuppressants, it is different in different diseases, different dose to start with, different tapering schedule. And there is no gold standard tapering schedule. It is different for different diseases. So, you know, it's a different topic altogether. I will just have an overview, like HP, oral corticosteroids. They are started with a dose of 0.5 mg per kg for 4 to 12 weeks. Then they are tapered over the period of 6 months. A bit longer period is advised for sarcoidosis, period of 9 to 12 months. For ARIA-ILD, they advise dose of 30, maximum 60 mg if there is a clinical worsening, and then rapidly tapering over the period of 3 months. Other immunosuppressive agents like methotrexate, cyclophosphamide can have a steroid sparing effect. Methotrexate has been advised to be stopped from pulmonologists, but rheumatologists don't agree with that. Many rheumatologists, their school of thought, don't agree with that. They feel that methotrexate induced ILD, like the percentage is very, very small, negligible, and benefit is much more. Scleroderma, they always advise low dose steroids. They advise 10 mg or less to be the maintenance dose, because there is always risk of going patient going in the renal crisis. So other drugs are cyclophosphamide. Azathioprine is a good alternative for maintenance therapy. Rituximab could be chosen in the refractory scleroderma. So organizing pneumonia, eosinophilic pneumonia, CTD, sarcoidosis, they will respond well to the steroids. And in fact, in the case of OP, EP, and sarcoidosis, we can think of tapering them off and stopping them, weaning them off. No role of steroids in IPF except exacerbation, and no role in the occupational lung diseases. When actively treating ILD, these are the principles, actively treating ILD, objective measure of improvement should be used, including oximetry and the functional assessment protocols, which we have decided, discuss later. So in particular, when corticosteroids are used, there is, when we start them, there is initial boost. And patient might respond improvement, or even subjectively report an improvement, but there is no actual improvement. So we should not rely completely on them, and we should thoroughly assess the patient. Role of antifibrotics, FVC more than 50%, start with pirfenidone. If there is decline of more than 10% FVC on pirfenidone on the next assessment, think of shifting them to nintedanib. Same is with nintedanib. Combination of this, definitely studies are underway, but you know, safety is yet to be established. Next is palliative care. Vaccinations, they decrease infections and ultimately hospital visits, admissions and deaths. Oxygen therapy for patients with resting hypoxia less than 88%. NIV improves dyspnea, respiratory failure. Mechanical ventilation can be used for patients of ILD. For the cases in whom the cause is reversible. So someone coming with the heart failure, pulmonary edema, someone is coming with the infection, which is reversible. We can think of putting case of ILD on mechanical ventilation and pulmonary rehabilitation. So this is the one of the pathway advice for management of cough. Address the comorbidities which can cause cough, like reflux, OSA, emphysema, and chronic sinusitis. Non-specific therapies such as dextromethorphan. Other therapies with like oral steroids, gabapentin, thalidomide, although weak, can be thought of. Manage the comorbidities, they are frequently present. Gastroesophageal reflux, pulmonary hypertension, to be managed as per the pH protocol. Look for the lung cancer, especially in case of scleroderma. Patients are on steroids, so they tend to put on weight and they are vulnerable for OSA. Look for them and look for the pulmonary embolism. So now we come to lung transplantation. This is the only viable treatment which clearly provides the benefit in mortality benefit in advanced ILD, especially IPF. So criteria for referring the patient, histopath and radio diagnosis, evidence of UIP and fibrosing NSIP, just refer the patient. Abnormal lung function test, FVC less than 80%, DLCO less than 40%, dyspnea or functional limitation attributable to lung disease, any oxygen requirement. For inflammatory ILD, failure to improve dyspnea oxygen requirement in the follow-up assessment with optimum medical therapy. Indications for listing, decline in the FVC more than 10% or DLCO more than 50% during 6 months follow-up, desaturation to less than 88% or distance, 6 minute walk distance less than 250 meters and more than 50 meters decline over the 6 months period. Pulmonary hypertension on right heart catheterization, which we usually don't do on 2D echo, and hospitalization because of respiratory decline, pneumothorax or any acute event, embolism. So summary here is immunosuppression choice, dose, duration, they are specific for different diseases, and consider risk benefit while choosing drugs, dose, duration. Antifibrotics can be tried in chronic progressive fibrosing ILD. pH to be treated, worked up as a pH algorithm, supportive care, O2, NIV, treatment of comorbidities, vaccination, palliative care. Thank you.
So really nice presentation, Dr. Manas. I think we have tried to get across a very coherent point that history taking and a thorough physical examination is really important in ILD, given the fact that we have so much of hypersensitivity pneumonitis. So I think a very good presentation there. So the next presentation is by Dr. Rahish Ravindran. He will be talking about a rheumatologist perspective towards skin connective tissue ILD. And Dr. Rahish Ravindran is a consultant rheumatologist here in Jupiter Hospital. He has trained at various centers across the globe in Germany and presented many abstracts at ECR conferences. So Dr. Rahish, can you please begin your presentation?
So very good evening to everybody. First of all, I would like to thank Dr. Alpa, Tarang, Manas for giving me this opportunity to interact with you all. And obviously special mention to Manas for helping me generously with the slides. Okay, so I'll start off with my presentation. So I'll try to keep it as simple as possible. So basically the itinerary for today from my talk would be basic history taking, clinical examination, common disease associations, what are the investigations that needs to be done, and what are the possible treatment options depending upon what is the basic pathology that we are dealing with. So everything will lead to the lung and ILD. So starting with very basic stuff, so any patient I would, in my clinic, obviously would come with joint pains, muscle pains. So the dominant complaint in my OPD would be musculoskeletal first. Very rarely or a small percentage comes with other complaints. So arthritis, arthralgia, simple to differentiate. Arthritis, obviously there is pain and inflammation. Arthralgia, there is no inflammation. Muscle, very important because there are certain diseases which have predominant muscle involvement and which can involve the lungs as well. So you have to know what is the difference between myalgia and myositis or myopathies. Myalgia basically can be subacute to chronic. It is usually non-progressive. So usually strength is preserved, there is no atrophy. However, myopathy, there is significant muscle weakness, atrophy can be present in advanced diseases. And obviously the muscle enzyme markers are elevated. Skin, you start with the hair loss, skin rashes, photosensitivity, oral ulcers, painful and painless, very important. Usually lupus oral ulcers are painless, while Behcet's ANCA vasculitis ulcers are usually painful. Pigmentation, skin tightening, Raynaud's ulcers over the skin, over the tip of the fingers, scaly lesions can be noted on the palms, over other extensor aspect of the body. Nail lesions have to be looked into, where there can be some nail bed infarcts which could suggest for vasculitis. Puffy fingers, obviously, for MCTD, dermatomyositis, and other diseases. Eye, redness of eye, dryness of the eye, pain in the eye, if there is any vision involvement in the eye. So all of them can give us clues towards a particular spectrum of autoimmune disease. Either it could be vasculitis or other connective tissue disorders. ENT complaints, very important. Hearing loss, recurrent infection, recurrent sinusitis, epistaxis, change in voice, dry cough. All of them are very, very important histories that a rheumatologist should take to lead himself to a proper diagnosis. For example, ANCA vasculitis, they have a lot of ENT complaints. Recurrent sinusitis, hearing involvement, hemoptysis. So a lot of things help us to narrow down the investigative list. Dental dry mouth, recurrent dental caries, mucosal lesions. Many times the patient may not come and tell you that he has a dry mouth or she has a dry mouth unless and until you specifically ask for it. If the patient says that the dry mouth may not be really significant, the very important clue is recurrent dental caries. So many of our patients who are having Sjogren's or sarcoidosis have a lot of dental caries. So they don't really think that that's probably a history worth mentioning unless and until you ask for it or you look for it. Mucosal lesions, obviously, with many vasculitis and lupus, mucosal lesions can be seen. Cardiopulmonary, obviously, very important from the lung perspective. Breathlessness, cough, hemoptysis, pedal edema, dependent pedal edema, palpitations, angina. So these are the features which help us to find out whether probably there is some lung involvement happening along with the other complaints that the patient has. So you really need to ask for these questions. Sometimes in the initial presentations, joint may be the dominant complaint for the patient and patient may not be really interested in telling you other things because breathlessness, she doesn't know because she's not moving per se. Unless and until it's a class 4, class 3 breathlessness, the patient would not come and tell you that, she's been experiencing breathlessness because overall mobility is very much restricted. So she doesn't really know. So clinical examination helps in that, those scenarios. Gastrointestinal, definitely dyspepsia, dysphagia, reflux, very, very important. Abdominal pain, altered bowel habits, hematemesis, malignia. So all of them gives us clues to where exactly we are taking our diagnosis to. Obviously, patients with scleroderma can have reflux. There is a history, there is a theory that, reflux can lead to interstitial lung disease in the long run. So prevention of reflux is very important in the long run when you're treating a patient with scleroderma. So genetic urinary complaints, what is the urinary volume, if the patient has dysuria, if the patient has genital ulcer, these are for vasculitis. Sexual problems, very, very important. A lot of males do have erectile dysfunction with concomitant connective tissue disorders. Females, especially with Sjogren's, scleroderma, they have dyspareunia. So they don't come out and discuss all these things with them. So unless and until you have regarding the sexual problems. So these are all very, very important, which can affect the overall psyche of the patient as well. So I'll come to the physical examination. First of all, obviously specific to the cardiopulmonary system. So general examination would definitely look for clubbing, look for the saturation, look for blood pressure, respiratory system, obviously respiratory rate, putting a stethoscope on the base of the chest is definitely very, very important. wheezing can be seen in sarcoid, HP, bronchiolitis, and pulmonary hypertension, pilled edema, raised AVP, right paracentral heave, light, loud P2. So basically a good physical examination, especially focusing towards the cardiopulmonary system, is very important in every connective tissue disorder, because lung is one of the major components that gets affected in a connective tissue disease. So Manas has already, you know, brushed through, obviously, but I'll go through it again. Basically, we have already discussed. So look for alopecia, rashes, malar rash, enlarged salivary glands, telangiectasia. So there are specific features for particular diseases which can, you know, it's written on their face sometimes what is the diagnosis. So looking at every aspect of the patient is very, very important from head to toe. Nasal crusting, saddle nose, vasculitis is one of the diagnoses. Decreased mouth opening, systemic sclerosis, oral ulcers can be vaginitis, could be besets, could be lupus, dry mouth, obviously we have discussed. All these things we have already gone through. I don't want to waste too much of time on the same aspects. Raynaud's, skin thickening, skin tightness, puffiness of the fingers, calcinosis, Gautran's papules, joint swelling, you know, synovitis, erythema nodosum, very, very important when you are looking at the hands and the legs. Skin tightening, and there is a Rodnan, modified Rodnan score, which helps us to quantify the skin tightening and helps us to, you know, find out whether the skin is improving or not. Although it takes a long time for the skin to improve, in, especially in scleroderma. What are the common disease associations that are seen with lung? As far as connective tissue diseases are concerned, obviously the first would be systemic sclerosis. So features, obviously, we have gone through before, but swelling, puffy fingers, thickening of the skin, basically sclerodactyly can be seen. Patients do complain of Raynaud's phenomena. Musculoskeletal patients can have arthralgia, arthritis, myalgia, myositis, gastrointestinal, obviously dysphagia, dyspepsia, reflux issues, malabsorption, issues, altered bowel habits. So all of these are dominant features of systemic sclerosis, which has lung as a major component of disease involvement. Second very common is myositis, basically inflammatory myositis. So symmetrical proximal muscle weakness, difficulty in climbing stairs, difficulty in getting up from sitting posture, difficulty in combing hair, myalgia, can be associated with joint pain and swelling. Erythema, obviously we have looked into that. Reddish rashes over sun exposed areas. So these are basic features where clinical examination and history taking helps us to pinpoint the diagnosis, or at least go tell us that probably the muscle is also involved along with the other features that the patient might be having. Rheumatoid, yes, no doubt about it. Generally, the dominant component is the joint rather than the lung. But obviously, every patient with any joint complaint, obviously lung examination is very, very important. Sjogren's, fatigue, dryness of skin, mouth dryness, eye dryness, Raynaud's phenomena can be seen. Arthralgias and myalgias are also seen in Sjogren's syndrome. These are the common diseases that we see in our OPD, which have lung as a involvement. Lupus, obviously. Lung per se may not be, ILD may not be a dominant feature of lupus, but lupus can present with many other acute presentations like diffuse alveolar or hemorrhage and pulmonary embolism. Those are the dominant features of lupus rather than ILD per se. Vasculitis, as I said, ANCA-associated vasculitis is very commonly associated with the lung. Vaginose can have alveolar, diffuse alveolar hemorrhage, can have cavitating lesions, hemoptysis. So you have to pick the certain things up early so that you can focus your investigation and treatment quickly and effectively for such patients. So basic pulmonary manifestations of connective tissue disorders are basically ILD contributes around 30% of all the cases of ILD. It may precede systemic manifestations in some diseases. Rheumatoid, very rarely. But dominant features are joint, but yes, polymyositis, dermatomyositis, scleroderma, lung can be a dominant feature in certain diseases. More favorable prognosis than idiopathic interstitial pneumonia. Why? Because patients who have ILD and have CTD we have a fighting chance that if you treat the patient in time before the fibrosis happens, the outcomes are much, much better. So linking your ILD with a possible connective tissue disorders is definitely a good news for the patient. So systemic sclerosis, around 45% of the patients have ILD. Myopathies have 40%. Rheumatoid has 10%, which are clinically significant. 30% who really don't have much symptoms. Sjogren's, 25 to 40%, very variable. MCTD, yes. I definitely look for, whenever I have a diagnosis of MCTD with me, I definitely look for the lung. Or at least, you know, I ask for a CT scan to, you know, look for early lung involvement if I'm not able to get any clinical features. Lupus, infrequent, not very common. Again, systemic sclerosis, effusion, pulmonary vascular disease, basically pulmonary arterial hypertension is one of the major and very, difficult things to treat with systemic sclerosis. Autoimmune myopathies, aspiration pneumonia, respiratory muscle function dysfunctions can lead to a lot of complications. Rheumatoid, yes, cricoarthroid, arthritis, bronchiolitis obliterans, can have pleural effusion, pleuris nodules. Obviously, PH also is one of the features, but not very common. Sjogren's, obliterative bronchiolitis, constrictive bronchiolitis, MCTD, yes, ILD is one of the features. Aspiration pneumonia can happen. Lupus, again, as I've already discussed, pleuritis, bronchiolitis, diffuse alveolar hemorrhage may be dominant presenting features. So importance of linking your ILD with a CTD is because the response is much better. Survival advantage, because there is a lot of NSIP pattern which we see in connective tissue disorders, is basically inflammation. So we can treat the inflammation rather than the fibrosis. So management decision, immunosuppression versus antifibrotics. If it is idiopathic pulmonary fibrosis, immunosuppression may not help. It's more dominantly the antifibrotics that becomes the mainstay. From as far as the autoimmune point of view, immunosuppression definitely helps the lung and definitely improves the overall prognosis of the patient. Investigations and imaging. The moment you are thinking of a connective tissue disorder and the lung involvement, these are the very basic stuff that we need to send. Rheumatoid arthritis, anti-CCP, and ANA. These are the common things that, as a rheumatologist, I send for everybody. Once the ANA comes positive, then I may ask for an ANA profile depending upon what exactly I'm looking at. Suppose if it's a dominantly, you know, skin involvement, scleroderma-like features, obviously I would prefer to send an extranuclear antigen. If there is muscle involvement, then myositis profile is something which I would send. Because choosing your investigation is very important, because first of all, they are very, very expensive tests. We cannot ask for repeated tests which are very, very expensive. So your first test should be really gaining the maximum information that you want. So choosing a test wisely is very, very important. So getting the clinical history, getting the examination findings, narrowing down your focus areas to a few diseases. Obviously, some initial investigations like ANA, RF factor, CCP helps to decide which direction would you go. And then you can choose the other next set of investigations. So routine laboratory investigations, initially in lupus, you may have leukopenias and basically cytopenias, so which are very less commonly seen in other diseases like systemic sclerosis and rheumatoid. Sjogren's can have lymphopenia. Systemic sclerosis, usually it's iron deficiency anemia because of malabsorption. Renal profile, obviously lupus, nephritis, scleroderma can have renal crisis, blood urea, creatinine, urine analysis, very important for, you know, classifying the overall disease spectrum. Liver profile, raised AST, ALT can be one of the features for myositis, or it could be autoimmune hepatitis as well. Other creatinine kinase, aldolase, and LDH for myositis. Acute phase reactants. Yes, ESR increases during the acute phase, but it is, less specific to any particular disease. CRP, yes, it's one of the go-to tests from the rheumatology point of view, because it shows, it changes very quickly. So that gives us a baseline idea of how the patient is responding to your therapy. It basically increases within 4 to 6 hours after inflammation, peaks at 2 to 3 days, half-life of around 18 hours. So CRP is something which, as a rheumatologist, I am much more fond of rather than the ESR. CRP in RA, obviously more sensitive as compared to ESR, correlation with progressive progression and erosive disease. Systemic sclerosis, correlation with skin thickening, very important, correlation with ILD, acute exacerbation. Especially lupus, suppose if there is lung involvement and we are not whether sure whether there is infection or not. If the CRP is normal in lupus, then it is disease activity. So that's a very, very important test from the lupus point perspective, because lupus has anti-CRP antibodies. So a patient with lung involvement in lupus with a normal CRP, it is disease activity. Don't waste your time and start away with, you know, start with immunosuppressant drugs and don't worry about the infection part. If the CRP is high, it could be either ways, because serositis per se can cause CRP to increase, or infections also can cause the CRP to increase. So if in lupus CRP is normal, it is definitely disease activity. Polymyositis, dermatomyositis, ESR per se CRP may not be really significant, but ESR, high, very high ESRs definitely can point towards possible occult malignancies, because dermatomyositis is associated with occult malignancies, especially solid organ tumors. So dermatomyositis with very high ESR, you should look for malignancies. Obviously, most of us from the rheumatology point of view ask for a PET CT when the diagnosis is dermatomyositis. KL6 per se I've never used, but then yes, it helps in differentiating between active pneumonitis and inactive pneumonitis. So the cutoff values is more than 180 units per ml. Values of around 500 to 700 definitely is conclusive of an active pneumonitis. So KL6 can be used. I per se have not used it yet. Coming to the antibodies, yes, we have already discussed that what all needs to be sent. ANA subsets, obviously dsDNA for lupus, antihistone for lupus. Extranuclear antigen is something which you are interested as per the lung point of view. RNP, very important. Anti-Ro, anti-La, very important, because Sjogren's is associated with pulmonary arterial hypertension without or with ILD. SCL70, obviously, scleroderma. Jovan, anti-synthetase syndrome, myositis. And PM1 also for myositis. So significance of ANA. ANA helps us in narrowing down the diagnosis to a great extent, especially with lupus, systemic sclerosis. Almost 90% of the patients with systemic sclerosis will have an ANA positive. Taran, I'm going to ask you that question in your presentation, where SCL70 is positive. So dermatomyositis, Sjogren's syndrome, with connective tissue disorder, so they can have ANA positivity. Monitoring prognosis per se, ANA may not be a really, helpful tool. But somebody who comes with a Raynaud's phenomena with no other clinical features, it may help you to narrow down to primary or secondary Raynaud's other than the nail fold capillaroscopy. The ANA definitely helps us to think that probably it's a secondary Raynaud's rather than a primary Raynaud's. I'll not go into the details of the techniques, but yes, patterns, very important. Speckled pattern, there are certain antigens which give speckled pattern, homogeneous peripheral nucleolar centromere. So these are the few patterns that are important for us from the clinical point of view to diagnose, to choose the specific antibodies that we need to send once the ANA comes positive. So speckle, definitely you have to look, send for even RNP, anti-Ro, anti-La. So if you want to, if your diagnosis is not systemic sclerosis or myositis, and if your diagnosis is towards lupus or mixed connective tissue disorder or Sjogren's, you can narrow down your investigations to even RNP, anti-Ro and anti-La. You can just stick to that. You need not worry about SCL70, Jovan and Ribosomal P, because all of them are expensive. I'm not a big fan of ANA blot, but somehow gradually after leaving the institute in private practice, I have started sending ANA blots for some reason which I don't know, but I do send ANA blots, but I'm not a big fan of line immunoassay. There are a lot of false positive tests that can come. Nucleolar, yes, obviously, polymerase 3, anti-U3 RNP. Centromere, definitely important, because if the pattern is centromere, then you need not send anything specific per se, because if you have clinical features of limited systemic sclerosis like scleroderma, Raynaud's, skin brightening, and you have an ANA with centromere positive, your diagnosis is more or less fixed. And you should look for the lung if there is ILD and PH, because anti-centromere antibodies are commonly associated with pulmonary arterial hypertension. Again, all these antibodies with disease and sensitivity, dsDNA, SM, CCP, anti-SCL70 is what we are looking at. Systemic sclerosis, anti-RNA polymerase 3 is important. I'll come to the specific antibodies. So diffuse systemic sclerosis, topoisomerase 1 is basically SCL70. They have more ILD, they can have renal crisis, they can have cardiac involvement. U3 RNP has more pulmonary arterial hypertension, RNA polymerase 3 have extensive skin involvement, less of lung involvement, and renal crisis is something which we need to be worried about. Centromere, as I've already discussed, it's basically isolated PH, less of ILD, digital ischemia, calcinosis can also be seen. Myositis, obviously, anti-JO1, definitely anti-synthetase syndrome. You can have mechanics hands if you are used to looking at the hands and the skin for all patients with connective tissue disorder. Anti-MDFI, very important, because it's usually associated with dermatomyositis, which has no specific muscle involvement. So clinically, amyopathic dermatomyositis. So anti-MDFI can be sent if you feel that there is significant myositis, but however, other features of dermatomyositis, but no muscle involvement. Anti-Me2 can also be sent. Basically, it's a myositis profile that we are looking at. And ANCA, obviously, CNCAS, PNCAS, MPO and PR3 definitely helps us to isolate which kind of disease or ANCA-associated vasculitis you're looking at. Vaginas, and basically we don't call vaginas nowadays, it's either GPA or EGPA. So we can differentiate between the two with considering the pattern that we can see. And obviously past history of bronchial asthma, eosinophils in the blood. So that narrows down the diagnosis to EGPA. And obviously CT scan and other parameters help us to diagnose the vaginas for the GPA. CNK, PR3 alone, vaginous microscopic polyangiitis and Churg-Strauss. PNK, MPO alone, definitely Churg-Strauss microscopic polyangiitis. And a typical ANCA can be seen in many other diseases, including rheumatoid. This is the myositis profile that we sent. Anti-JO1 is something which we see commonly from the myositis point of view. So that helps us to diagnose myositis and obviously look for ILD. This is a very beautiful chart which was shared by Dr. Manas regarding the overall approach to autoimmune antibodies that we send. So ANA positive, you should start thinking of MCTD, lupus, systemic sclerosis, and Kress syndrome. If you're thinking of MCTD, send UNRNP. This is what I was discussing, that you can narrow down the set of investigations so that you can save a lot of money for the patient, because very, very expensive tests we are looking at. If the ANA is negative, if you start thinking of other possibilities like myositis or probably an overlap syndrome, if the ANCAs are positive, obviously MPO, PR3 MPO can be sent. Imaging wise, CT thorax with HRCT cuts with contrast, look for sarcoid, can have mediastinal lymph nodes, lung involvement. Second would be pulmonary function test with DLCO, helps us to characterize the overall lung involvement that we have at the baseline. Obviously helps us to compare when we are doing repeat follow-up tests, so that we have a baseline and then compare it with how the patient is responding to our therapy. 2D echo, obviously, to look for PH, right heart catheterization, not easy to get it done here, but 2D echo, definitely yes, for looking for pulmonary arterial hypertension. BAL, I think Manas has already discussed on that. Lung biopsy, when you're not really sure what's happening and you don't have clear-cut diagnosis, lung biopsy definitely helps. And that lung biopsy may be required when you want to know the disease activity versus the fibrosis if no other features are helping you out. So spirometry, usually a restrictive defect can be seen. Lung volumes are usually reduced.
I think we'll come up in the panel discussion also. Yes,
definitely. Yeah. So nothing specific. I think Manas has discussed most of the things. Drug-wise, I think we can have a discussion during the panel discussion. Not a problem. One point I would want to mention is this one. Does methotrexate cause ILD? I had a discussion with Manas and Tarang. I don't agree. There is some proof. Methotrexate, there are a lot of studies. Patrick Kelly is one of very famous investigators who's working on rheumatology perspective. So a lot of papers recently, very recently published papers, they say that methotrexate is not. So please stop saying that ki aapko Dr. Raish ke dawa se ya rheumatology ke dawa se aapka lung kharab hua hai. Theek hai? So I think I rest my case with two papers where methotrexate per se doesn't cause ILD. So obviously it's a teamwork with the pulmonologist and the rheumatologist and obviously the radiologist and the pathologist in the loop. So thank you very much for your patient listening, and we can have a discussion later on the treatment aspects during the panel discussion.
Thank you, Dr. Rahish. So finally, it seems like there is truth now where, as far as methotrexate is concerned. So the next session here is right now a multidisciplinary discussion on a case of CTD-ILD. So in this session, Dr. Mehul Thakkar, who is a consultant here in Jupiter Hospital and director of Medansh Super Speciality Hospital, will be moderating the session. I will be presenting the case, and we have a panel of specialists who would help us with the case. The pulmonologist for this case would be Dr. Alpa Dalal and Dr. Raju. Dr. Raju is one of the most senior most pulmonologists here in the city and also has been associated with Jupiter Hospital as a consultant. The rheumatologist in this panel would be Dr. Rahish Ravindran, whom you just heard. The radiologist would be Dr. Kalashree Bandekar, who's also a consultant here at Jupiter Hospital. And we would also be joined by Dr. Ankita Asher, who is the consultant in cardiopulmonary rehabilitation in our department. And she has done some really exciting work as far as rehabilitating ILD patients is concerned. So, and I would be presenting the case. Dr. Mehul?
Yep, I'm here.
Yes.
Let's go for it. I know people are waiting for this. So we save the best for the last. Come on.
So I'd be sharing my case here. Is it visible?
Yes.
Yes.
Absolutely.
So this is my case. The cases of a 46-year-old female who was present in September 2017. She was complaining of shortness of breath for almost 8 years, which was initially grade 2 and had worsened recently. She also had dry cough since last 4 years, and which was not accompanied with wheeze and chest tightness. She did complain of hair loss and skin tightening since 4 years, and there was strong history suggestive of Raynaud's phenomena. The patient did complain of a lot of reflux and was having pedal swelling since the last 10 days. She was treated as airway disease outside and was given high dose inhaled corticosteroids, but there was no relief. In the physical examination, the patient had pedal swelling, she had clubbing, and she had pallor. There was significant skin tightening, and on examination, the JVP was raised. On cardiac auscultation, the P2 was loud, and the patient was hypoxic with 90% saturation at room air. I mobilized with the patient in the OPD, and the saturations dropped to around 75% just after a few steps. On auscultation, there were bilateral infrascapular and inspiratory coarse crepitations. So this was a chest X-ray.
So yeah, let me just take over from here. This was the X-ray with the prolonged history and a patient who's hypoxic on mobilization. So I would like to bring in first the radiologist here, Dr. Kalashree. What do you think? How would you describe this X-ray, given the historical background that you have?
Okay, so the first thing which I would want to notice in this is that this is not a chest X-ray which is taken in a good inspiratory. The patient has not been able to take a full inspiration. So this is sort of a mid-inspiratory film, which also would raise the possibility of a reduced lung volume. So that is what comes to my mind, giving the clinical history. Also, I see very fine but well-defined reticular opacities, which seem to be centered more in the peripheral aspects of the mid and lower zones, bilaterally symmetrical. Otherwise, I don't see any evidence of pleural effusion or any kind of an apical fibrosis or no obvious paratracheal widening or anything to suggest a mediastinal lymphadenopathy. I don't, the visualized bony thorax, there is no, everything appears normal. There's no obvious osteoarticular disease. So this would raise the suspicion of an interstitial lung disease, which would warrant a do I have to repeat all over again or
no,
was
that's
I audible at least?
The last part we missed. Okay, so while we get her
this,
back, I'll just put the,
with the clinical yeah. background, this raises the possibility of an interstitial. Huh.
Okay.
Yeah, interstitial lung disease. Yeah, I would like just to stress one point that even when we send a patient for a chest X-ray, mentioning a short history sometimes helps the radiologist with a, you know, giving you a good diagnosis, because many a times we miss out writing history when you're sending for chest X-rays or a CT scan. Now, I'd like to bring here Raju sir in. Sir, with the available history and the chest X-ray, what would be your provisional diagnosis and how would you approach this case? What would you do next?
Apart from what Kalashi has said, what I'm observing is there is a little increase in the size of the cardiac solute, which probably points towards some sort of a failure. Maybe it's a involving heart, and the right pulmonary stems also seems to be a little more prominent. I'm not seeing the left one as prominent. And then, as she rightly said, this looks like some sort of an interstitial because it's reticular pattern. It's mostly in the lower and probably middle zone also. And otherwise, the X-ray chest, as she said, not taken in a full inspiration. So some of the features may not be quite obvious here.
So do you have a differential diagnosis of ILD in this?
ILD, of course. And then we also have to think in terms of some sort of a cardiorespiratory ailment, maybe some sort of a with the history of cough and breathlessness, which has been given to us. Maybe he have some cardiac involvement here.
Okay. Tarang, go ahead.
So then looking at this X-ray, we went ahead for a CT scan. And
so again, I would like to involve the radiologist.
Yeah. Am I audible
two
now?
Two questions I have for you. Yeah. Are you audible? I have two questions for you. First of all, for the interest of the audience, you need to tell us what constitutes an ideal HRCT film. Sometimes what happens is we get a lot of CT scan, but we don't see quite a bit of details in it, or we feel the details are not seen. They might be seen on the console. So maybe you can brief us a little about how an ideal CT should be done, at least an HR cuts when you're suspecting an ILD, and we need you to interpret the CT that you're seeing.
So an adequate and satisfactory HRCT would involve essentially the following components. It needs a slice thickness of 0.625 to 1.25 mm, a very short scan time, a very thin collimation of 1.5 to 3 mm, a reconstruction which is done in a high spatial frequency or a bone algorithm with a patient good breath hold. If all these conditions or criteria are fulfilled, then what we get is a very crisp and a good quality HRCT study. Now, the problem with reporting on films is that films are necessarily always essentially given by the technicians. And unless they are specifically told about areas to be highlighted, I think there is a general pattern in which HRCT films are printed and given to the patient. Hence, it is really a good idea to ask for a CD which can be uploaded and which involves all the sections of the lung and which gives a very good comparison for the present and the future scans. So routinely we conduct all the HRCTs in a prone position, supine position. Prone CT scans would be necessary for suspected ILDs, and expiratory scans are necessary for obstructive lung diseases to delineate areas of air trapping. So if these all conditions with are fulfilled, then the HRCT which is obtained is of a good reportable quality.
What do you see in the scan? Even the background history and suspected ILD. I mean, what do you think? What do you see in the scans?
Okay, so can I have the HRCT window? This is what is being displayed. Yeah. So here we have the actual HRCTs of the lung, and which show basically a very large component of pulmonary fibrosis, which is evident in the form of architectural distortion. There is coarse intra-intralobular septal thickening with variable size subpleural cysts and areas of honeycombing. I don't see any pleural effusions or consolidations, and there is due to the pulmonary fibrosis also mildly reduced volumes of both the lower lobes. Otherwise, this would be put into a non-specific interstitial pneumonitis kind of a pattern with in a fibrotic stage. I think the next slide would also delineate the same this thing, and this has a distinctly predominantly a lower lobe extensive involvement, which is also obvious. Okay, so these are the mediastinal windows at the level of the origin of the brachiocephalic artery, and which shows an obvious gross abnormal dilatation of the esophageal lumen and with presence of some air fluid levels within, which suggests retained contents. So this patient is at a high risk of aspiration pneumonitis if these amount of retained contents are going to be there in the esophagus. The next, I think, was that of the pulmonary artery and its bifurcation. It has not been measured on this film, but there's mild prominence of the pulmonary trunk, and if measured more than 2.9 centimeters, indicates the presence of a pulmonary hypertension, which is a very common accompaniment of scleroderma as compared to the other connective tissue disorders and needs to be investigated further. Otherwise, I don't see any mediastinal lymphadenopathy or any pleural effusion as such.
Okay. Now, in any ways, it is sad that the patient presented with just such a delayed stage of fibrosis and was not diagnosed. And I would expect patient who's hypoxic to have some amount of pulmonary hypertension. So that is something which we should all look for.
Yes. Now, so the giveaway in this patient was the esophageal dilatation, which raises the strong suspicion. Otherwise, the lung findings are not very typical of scleroderma, as we would call it. It is more of an NSI pattern, but accompanied with esophageal dilatation, it should raise the flag.
Yeah, thanks for that. And now let's get back to the clinical picture. Alpha ma'am, if you see such a patient and you've seen the CT, what would you be thinking? How would you go ahead with the management? What would be the overall prognosis of such a patient? How will you progress further?
So, yes. Hello, am I audible?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah. So, can I get into the... Yeah. So now this patient, we are seeing that this patient is symptomatic for 8 years. She's already come with a hypoxia baseline saturation of 90% and further significant desaturation. She has pleural edema. She has symptoms and signs suggestive of connective tissue disease. And she already seems to in advanced stage from whatever is appearing clinically and also what features we are seeing on HRCT. Now, as a clinician, when I look at the HRCT report, what are the prognosticating markers? So when a patient with connective tissue disease or suspected CTD has a HRCT feature, which is suggestive of already fibrosis that is set in, as you can see in this patient, she already has multiple cysts. She has reticular pattern. She is showing traction bronchiectasis, and then seems to be extensive area of destruction and also associated pulmonary hypertension. So obviously, all these CT and clinical features suggest that prognosis does not seem to be very good. And when a patient comes with these kind of clinical picture and radiological picture, I would classify her as a severe CTD with advanced and already having complications. So to begin with, I would actually like to hospitalize this patient and then work up and find out what's been happening, investigate her thoroughly and see what are the correctable factors in this patient. But depending on this clinical and radiological finding, this patient has severe progressive ILD with connective tissue disease.
Okay, so now we've moved till here, we've achieved the diagnosis more or less, and we know what is going to be the plan of action. So let's move ahead, Param.
So these are the investigations that we sent. So the CTD markers, as Dr. Rahish said, the primary investigations that we need to send, ANA, RA, and anti-CCP, all three were negative. We also did an echocardiography where the LVF was fine, 68%. There was dilated RA-RV with an impaired RV systolic function and a pulmonary pressure of 97 mmHg.
So let's get in, Dr. Rahish. Now we have a patient who has clinical features suggestive of a CTD, has ILD, has pulmonary hypertension, but now the ANA is negative. So how will you help us? I'm referring the patient to you. So how will you help us and how will you investigate this patient? Because I suspect strongly a CTD ILD in this patient. Dr. Rahish?
So you're on mute. You're on mute, sir.
Yeah, I'm so sorry. Yeah, so if your primary diagnosis is connective tissue disease, based on the clinical features and not just imaging findings. So imaging findings helps us to know the extent of the disease. Okay, so when you are looking at a CTD, it's the whole picture, the whole, the presentation of the patient, including the skin, including the joints and everything. So that narrows down the diagnosis to what you are looking at. Suppose if there is ANA is negative, I'm really not worried. Okay, I'm looking at other things probably which will help us to diagnose other connective tissue disorders. For example, it could be a dermatomyositis. Okay, it could be sarcoid. It could be, Sjogren's where ANA can be negative. So once ANA is negative, we really should not be worried if the other features are in favor of connective tissue disorder. Sometimes ANA can be negative in very, as I said, in systemic sclerosis per se, majority of them have an ANA positive status, unless or until it's probably an anti-centromere antibody, which may be positive, where ANA can be negative. So limited scleroderma can have an ANA negative, but limited scleroderma doesn't present with gross ILDs. It's usually a pulmonary arterial hypertension that is the major presenting feature. So if ANA is negative, think of other causes. Look for the muscle involvement, look for other skin features which can give you an alternative diagnosis. So I really don't base my thought process or diagnosis on investigations imaging findings. I would rather put my bet on my clinical judgment before I decide on any further investigations. Even if the ANA is negative, I really am not worried if I'm sure that it's a connective tissue with a lung involvement.
Okay, so but we were very adamant and we still went ahead and getting a blood test done. Atharan can show it.
Yeah.
So and this is what we got. Yes. And now we again refer back the patient to you. And
so
how would you depict this?
I mentioned this during my talk that Tarang, I'll come to that. Because see, SCL70 is a subset of ANA. You're getting the point. Okay, so generally if ANA is negative and SCL70 per se coming positive, the chances are less. Okay. So it's usually the anti-centromere which presents with the ANA negative status. Okay, so but I as I said, the blot, I'm not a very big fan, but yes, if it's SCL70 positive and you are clinically convinced that it is scleroderma, I think we should go ahead and, diagnose the patient as scleroderma.
So I would want to ask Dr. Rahish here, is there any way the false negative ANA can come if it's not done
yes.
in good lab?
It may have been done in different labs. Yeah, very true, ma'am. Very true. See, a false negative ANA can come, but then as I am stressing again and again, our judgment should be based on clinical features. If suppose the patient just comes with a lung involvement and absolutely no history of any other connective tissue disorder, then an ANA plus minus can help in some situations. I think we had a few patients like that, where there is no other feature of connective tissue disease, ANA is weakly positive and the lung involvement is there. So in such cases, it is basically, if it's an NSIP, it is inflammation. I think you should go ahead and start off with anti-inflammatory, irrespective of what the ANA is saying. So ANA is a very, operator-dependent test. So once we do it, it all depends upon how the reagenting we use, how long that reagent has been kept, how the microscopy is being used, how much the fluorescence has been added. So it's a very operator-dependent test. So really, you should not be worried about the plus and minuses of ANA. So some pathologists would report it as 2+, and somebody would say it's 1+. So it doesn't really matter unless and until your clinical judgment for that patient is on track. So ANA would be just as a additional marker for me.
Yeah, can I ask one more thing? Yes. Joining that question is, would you repeat an ANA in such a case? Like, as SCL70 is positive,
yeah, SCL70, yes. Yeah. Once SCL70, if I have the features of scleroderma, I can repeat the ANA for documentation purposes, but that doesn't really matter. But I would
change your mind.
I would tell them, just we'll repeat it from another lab, and see what comes up. But I'm not saying that I would do it, but we can. I think okay. I can.
Okay. Tarang, go back one slide. We need to talk about one more thing which is there. Now, in the echocardiography, it is seen that there was a dilated right heart and there was a pulmonary pressures of 97, which is very, very high. So I would like to ask the pulmonologist on panel, are you satisfied with the diagnosis of ILD and pulmonary hypertension? Are you happy with the diagnosis of ILD and the pulmonary hypertension, or you think there is something else funny which is going on? Maybe a CT pulmonary angio or something might be needed for such a patient.
Yes, so to be very specific, there is systemic sclerosis with pulmonary hypertension. One thing you have to be very clear that systemic sclerosis is a multi-organ disease with multiple pathways or multiple phenotypes where pulmonary hypertension can come. Now, in this particular case, definitely she is hypoxic with advanced lung fibrosis. So that's one thing that can explain the pulmonary hypertension. But such high pH, pulmonary artery pressure of 97, I would definitely like to rule out other causes of. I would request my cardiology colleague to look at the left heart also if she has LV dysfunction or if she has reduced LV failure, which is also very common when there is myocardial involvement with systemic sclerosis. So that could be. So in fact, when you talk of pulmonary hypertension, all the different groups. So one is very common, yes, group one, where you have vasculopathy and small vessel involvement. So then it will fall in group one. If they have ILD, like in this particular case, and hypoxias, and with so much of lung destruction, then it could be hypoxia related and interstitial lung disease. So that would be group three. That would be one phenotype. Third would be this patient, when they have myocardial involvement, they would have a left ventricular dysfunction, and it could be group.
Yeah.
Group.
How many are you reporting?
And I would also like to rule out. I would also like to rule out in these cases.
I can't really.
Dr. Kalashri, can you mute yourself? So I'd also like to rule out CT pulmonary angio and rule out the pulmonary thromboembolism, because this patient with high pH and systemic, CTD, they are also high risk for pulmonary embolism. So in fact, some of the patient may have multifactorial pulmonary hypertension, and I would like to rule out all these aspects. Because some of those aspects will definitely be treatable, and we may be able to bring down the pressure by 20 or 30. And that would also make a great improvement in her condition.
I think, yes, Prarissa, you want to add something to that?
Yeah. I think in this situation, that's why CTAP maybe, combined with echocardiography will give us much more definite picture about the cause of this thing. pulmonary hypertension, whether it is a vasculopathy or whether it's also combined with other involvement of the heart, particularly the chambers. So I think there we have a good sort of a investigation available to us, which is CTAP. And of course, a patient with this type of pulmonary hypertension in normally isolated, you don't see, but then it's possible to have.
Okay, so now let's come to the treatment part. Like, you had such a patient, and Alpana, how would you, investigate this patient now? You have an anti-SCL positive, you have echo, you have a CT chest. How will you go ahead with managing this patient? What will be the principle of management that you will follow?
Yeah, so basically, systemic sclerosis is a very devastating disease with multi-organ involvement. So we should be very clear on the goals of the management. So what important goal would be? First thing, that you need to improve the quality of life of the patient. So you need to give her a symptom relief. The second goal would be to prevent exacerbation. The third goal would be to prevent progression of the disease. The fourth goal would be to minimize the side effect of things. And the last one would be, if you are not able to achieve much of it, then should focus on the palliative care. So in this particular case, we can already see that she has an advanced disease. So as I told you, with this state, if the patient come to my OPD, I would request the patient to get hospitalized, where it's possible for me to involve multi-specialty consultants and get her thoroughly investigated to find out what can be reversed and what cannot be reversed. So then the first thing would come to pharmacotherapy. So in this patient's pharmacotherapy, we focus on the immunosuppressant. So as earlier discussed by Dr. Manas, so there is not much role of steroids in treating patients with systemic sclerosis, because it's known to precipitate renal crisis. If at all, to begin with, I may give her very low dose of oral corticosteroid, and then would like to rule out any presence of infection before I initiate any immunosuppressant. So the common immunosuppressant that's been used in systemic sclerosis, earlier it was cyclophosphamide, but now number of new studies have shown that MMF is equally effective, and probably it is much less toxic to the patient in terms of ADR profile. Recent studies have shown good results with rituximab. And so I would like to decide about the choice of immunosuppressant. And having said that, it should be very clear in the beginning to discuss with the patient the use of immunosuppressant, especially a case like this who already has advanced disease. So we do not know how much benefit it would be. So the risk-benefit ratio has to be discussed with the patient and then started off. Then I would be focusing on treating the comorbidities. Like, she already has GERD, she has pulmonary hypertension, so investigate and then focus on that. Symptom relief would be extremely important. Treating her right heart failure would be very important. So in this, and lastly, I would focus on non-pharmacological therapy. So taking care of her nutrition, pulmonary rehabilitation, and psychological counseling. Yoga, relaxation, all those things would be helpful, and the palliative care. And lastly, if patients are willing and think, then these are the patients who should be considered for lung transplantation. And very important component in this patient, when we are managing such kind of patients, we have to involve our rheumatologist, or we have to involve a rehab specialist and give her a kind of, and many times patients choose not to take the immunosuppressant therapy just because of bad ADR profile. So all that has to be taken into consider and have a holistic approach towards managing these patients.
Excellent. I would like to just make one comment that made it in the chat by Dr. Sridhar Chatterjee. The MMF will take at least a month to start acting. So that should be remembered. So the very well said, sir. I mean, the MMF is a slow acting drug. So as Dr. Atta was saying, we need to manage the patient in a multidisciplinary fashion, involve the rheumatologist, involve the cardiologist for help, and involve the pulmonary rehab specialist. So because we have a dilemma here that whether methotrexate causes ILD or not. So let's go to something which will not cause ILD and involve our physiotherapist on the panel. So Dr. Ankita, how will you manage this patient? Like ma'am said, she will involve you in management of this protocol. So how will you go ahead, and how do you think this will help the patient?
When we talk about this particular patient, we see that, okay, there is a chronic history since 8 years, and presently she has her baseline saturation is 90, and on minimal exertion, it went to 70. Also on the 6-minute walk test, the distance was 340 meters and the patient desaturated by 10%. Also, we know that the pulmonary artery pressure is 97. So in this particular kind of patient, initially I would like to start with simple breath retraining till the medicines and till there is an optimal medical management. So we start with simple postures which help them to control their breath during activity and even at rest. Also, we work on the muscles, on the respiratory muscles, which help her to increase the tidal volume. So we would start with improving her work of breathing. So involving her diaphragm, as a part of breathing, and active recruitment of the diaphragm is something that we will look at. And once the optimal medical management is done, then we will start with pulmonary rehab per se, where we will have a structured, a tailor-made exercise prescription for this particular patient, which will help her to improve her mobility, maintain whatever is presently there, improve her muscle endurance and strength both, and thereby improve her activity tolerance during daily activities, that activities of daily living, and also, other activities like social and, going out of the house kind of activities. So in this particular patient, since the pulmonary artery hypertension is present and she is hypoxic, I would also like to monitor this patient during activity with ECG and telemetry, so that, these are the kind of patients which have higher risk of getting arrhythmias during increasing the activity. So I would like to monitor her specifically with telemetry during the exercise and also during the stepping up.
So would you consider using oxygen therapy while giving the physio? Because patient was desaturating.
Of course.
Yeah. So Tarang, go ahead. Let's see what we got in the case.
So we discharged this patient with mycophenolate along with the was followed up after discharge, and she remained relatively stable for 14 months, after which she again came to the OPD with complaints of worsening shortness of breath, cough, and decreased exercise tolerance. So here we did the repeat CT scan. So these CTs are 14 months apart.
Okay, so I'd like to involve the radiologist again, Dr. Kalashree. You see this, the initial CT, and then we saw the patient has come back after 14 months of treatment with exacerbation complaints.
Right.
And now I need your help in two kind of things. First of all, would you think this is an infective? Because I don't know whether this is an infection, it's not an infection, disease has worsened, or we are living in COVID times. Is this COVID? So how will you help me out with this?
Okay. So what is glaring as a difference in both of these CT scans is that the one which is performed most recently has bilateral, fairly symmetrical areas of ground glass opacities, which are slightly in the perihilar region. Also, I don't see any definite formed consolidation or any cavitary or any other type of consolidations as such. And another striking feature of the comparative study is that the pulmonary fibrosis has significantly increased. So now in the repeat scan, I'm able to see more florid areas of subpleural cysts and honeycombing, and with absolutely an extensive involvement of bilateral lower lobes. So now in this scenario, if we have just ground glass opacities and which are bilateral symmetrical and with a history of worsening, has the patient significantly worsened in 1 month?
It's a 14 month gap and patient has worsened.
Okay, this recent scan, the indication for this recent scan was just a serial follow-up, or was it
no, significant patient worsening? Had come with worsening and we were worried. Patient was breathless.
Yeah. Yeah, so in fitting in with the clinical history and the morphological appearance on the CT scan, this looks more like a non-infective acute exacerbation of an ILD. The infective ILD, I would expect an area of consolidation which would be possibly more lobar in distribution with areas of air bronchogram or sometimes cavitating consolidation or a central breakdown. Also, I don't see any pleural effusions as such. So and in the so basically anything any ground glass opacities which are peripheral, multifocal, and diffuse GGOs have to raise the possibility of an acute exacerbation first. Also, I don't see any pulmonary infiltrates, nodular infiltrates, which would also again suggest possibility of an infective ILD.
Would it be COVID? I mean, we are living in a okay. This patient had not come during COVID times, but some sort of patient has come today.
Right.
Do you think this ground glass could be COVID?
Okay, so in imaging of COVID, we are seeing two different kind of HRCT appearances. COVID, which is imaged in the first 6 days of its presentation, has this typical ground glass opacities, but which are seen to be more of subpleural distribution in both the lungs diffusely. And of course, we are also seeing central ground glass opacities. And if you image the same patient from the 6 to 11 day, these subpleural opacities then organized into subpleural areas of consolidation or fibroatelectasis. So in terms of distribution, this is not very typical COVID, but considering that these are ground glass opacities again and bilateral, fairly symmetrical, yes, the second possibility of a COVID will have to be entertained.
And can this ground glass come in, say, maybe like a LVF or left ventricular failure or CCO pattern, do you think?
Pulmonary edema, yes, pulmonary edema again, but then I would again expect some amount of cardiomegaly with maybe some pericardial or pleural effusion also accompanying it to give me a higher degree of confidence, yes.
Okay. Let's go ahead, Tara.
Yes, so this was diagnosed as an acute exacerbation of SSC ILD, and he was treated accordingly. So,
next slide.
So this was a comparison of the pulmonary function test. So the first table, if you look at the FVC values, September 2017, when So if you just focus on the FVC values in the first table, on presentation, the FVC was 1.5 liters, which is 64% predicted. And after this exacerbation, was treated, the FVC had dropped to 1.2 liters, 52% predicted. Similarly, the KCO and the 6-minute walk test distance had also decreased. If you look at the second table, while on treatment, there wasn't a very significant decrease in the FVC, while the 6-minute walk distance actually had increased in March 2018 after almost 6 months of treatment. Similarly, even after this exacerbation, if we compare the PA, the pulmonary artery pressures, they had grossly increased to 104 from 97 mmHg. So this was after 14 months of follow-up. There was worsening of FVC, there was worsening of 6-minute walk distance, worsening of the pulmonary artery systolic pressures, and also the KCO.
Yeah, so this begs the question now, what is our treatment doing? Probably treatment is not working or the patient has come in exacerbation. So I would like to involve here Dr. Raju and Dr. Alpatara. Okay, what would you do? How will you manage an exacerbation of ILD? Specifically stressing on the role of steroids, because as soon as a patient of ILD enters an exacerbation, first thing the clinician does is gives one shot of steroid before even getting a CT done or anything. So how will you manage an exacerbation of ILD?
Okay, so once you have established that it's an exacerbation, of course, with all the parameters which is falling into place, that it is a sudden onset increase in his parameters which has gone down. And of course, we have an objective assessment also telling us that there is a sharp fall in the respiratory parameters. So it tells us that this is an acute exacerbation. First, we have established this is an acute exacerbation. Now, this thing is a patient who is otherwise going on well and suddenly got into problems. So of course, there's a lot of work on exacerbation, but then it is said that most of these works are related to IPF. So one of these problems with IPF also, we are still not established what are the various real causes. But then it is estimated that most of these are because of environmental pollution to irritants, to viral agents, to infections, to everything. So at the moment, in this particular patient, we are not finding any infective episodes. So maybe we will be treating it according to the protocol which we use in our IPF. Only thing is here, probably we have to be very careful in scleroderma to use our steroid in a manner which we normally use in IPF. So we have to be very careful because of renal crisis, which can happen in these cases. And of course, we'll be managing case to case basis by looking at his oxygen saturation to ABG to other aspect of this thing, whether he requires a support of ventilation by oxygen and whether ventilatory support by relieving his work of breathing by doing a non-invasive mode of ventilation. And of course, that is the way we will be going ahead.
Very well said, sir. Ma'am, would you like to add something to this?
Yeah, so I think the important point to be stressed upon is, unlike other ILD exacerbations, here steroids, you have to be very judicious. You should not use very high dose of steroid, especially in systemic sclerosis, because it can precipitate renal crisis. And you have to thoroughly rule out infection. So like CT scan is, she has already said, Dr. Kalashree, that it there have not featured, but something like PCP or even COVID infection can be there. So we do markers like CRP, we do PCT levels, we send cultures, urine culture, blood cultures, and be very sure that the infection is not there. At times we do a quick lavage also to rule out any infections. And once we have ruled out the infection, then we treat the acute exacerbation. So even use of cyclophosphamide pulse therapy or rituximab can be considered in such situation.
Well said, ma'am. But like, if such a patient got admitted, you treated with the steroids or cyclophosphamide. Now, I would like to ask you and Dr. Ankita, when would you like to start the pulmonary rehab? The patient was already on rehab. The patient was doing good amount of physio. Now has come in an exacerbation, probably has become decompensated. So what will be the timing when you would involve a physiotherapist? Dr. Ankita, when would you would like to join in battling this ILD?
Once the inflammation is slightly, under control and the patient is, able to maintain, he's not that breathless during the resting period, I would like to, start with rehab at that time. After, say, 2 weeks of acute exacerbation, I think should be the right time when we can start a structured rehab program. But meanwhile, we can we can at least give them some amount of breath retraining during the acute phase so that the pattern of breathing is maintained. Ma'am, Dr. Dalla, Alpa ma'am, would you like to add something?
Yeah, so two things are important. That one is, most of the time the clinician and the patient itself, when they are in acute symptom, they are quite shocked when we also mention about physiotherapy. Okay, so we have to know what kind of physiotherapy can be introduced at that stage. So it can be started in an acute phase in a very, very slow manner and focused on breath retraining. Second thing is, sometimes people are very over enthusiastic about making patient do the exercises. So, you just make the patient because in exacerbation, you have to be very careful how you introduce, at what the extent or what kind of exercises you give to the patient. And once the patient is a little better off to do more physical activity, then that's why involvement of cardiopulmonary physiotherapy is very, very important, because they understand the physiology and accordingly they would give their therapy to the patients.
Okay, I think we're overshooting time, so let's just wrap up. I have 2-3 questions left, one for each panelist. One would be for Dr. Raish, like, in such a case of SSC-ILD, what are the drugs that you would prefer to continue? Like, patient has now got admitted, and again, you've got a reference that patient has come and this thing is there. So what drugs would you give, and what overall, just give us a brief how will you monitor this patient in your OPD once the patient is discharged? So you are on mute, Dr. Raish, you are on mute.
Basically, what we can see is that there is worsening while on treatment per se. So obviously, we need to step up the therapy, as ma'am has already mentioned, that cyclophosphamidase would be a better choice, would be the next choice in these kind of situations once we rule out infection. One point I really need to mention is regarding the steroid part and the renal crisis part. I think we are a little paranoid about the renal crisis part. As far as the Indian cohort is concerned, the chances of renal crisis with half milligram, 0.5 mg per kilogram of steroids is hardly seen. So it is not just my observation. This has been discussed time and again at various rheumatology forums, including the senior most rheumatologists in the country. The chances of renal crisis from the Indian point of view, the Indian cohort point of view, is hardly a risk factor. So using steroids at least by 0.5 mg per kilogram during acute exacerbation should not be a worrying factor for renal crisis. So I think we should be very much assured from the renal crisis point of view, which is very, very rare from the Indian point of view, I'm saying. The second point is when the patient comes to me after the doses of cyclophosphamide, if we have started off with that, is obviously looking for the overall general condition of the patient, other parameters which include the skin, which includes the joint, which includes tendons. A lot of patients do have a lot of tenosynovitis in these patients. So extra pulmonary manifestations of systemic sclerosis, how it is faring well. The lung obviously may take some time considering the pulmonary arterial hypertension and fibrosis. So to follow up, obviously I will look at the extra pulmonary manifestations of systemic sclerosis to see how the patient is responding overall. The lung obviously with serial PFTs and DLCOs and 2D echo evaluation, we can have a decent amount of idea about how the patient is responding. Obviously, cyclophosphamide would be continued as per protocol for at least 6 doses, and then we can decide on maintenance therapies.
Okay, Raju sir, how will you monitor such a patient like on after discharge? I mean, from like SSU ILD point of view, from the pulmonologist point of view, what will be your protocol for managing this or monitoring this patient?
Okay, so it all starts with history again. Actually, we have to revisit the history to understand whether a new problem has come on, whether he's starting more cough or more breathlessness, because these are the two important symptoms for which patient actually approaches doctor. So I think if it is a cough which is predominant, of course, we are giving either cyclophosphamide and MMF, which is supposed to be having a good effect on cough. But then in this particular case, I think she has a dilated esophagus leading to some sort of a GERD, which is predominantly causing her a cough. So we'll give a good treatment for the GERD and of course make her sleep in the left lateral position with the raised bed and all those things, which in many cases takes care of this cough, which is very horrible and troublesome to these patients. Of course, apart from that, of course, patient, depending on what is the hypoxic status, as it is, we have seen that she is on the verge of hypoxia in the initiation also. And later on, I think oxygen therapy has to be continued and she has to be continued with all the medication for this thing, and maybe some sort of reassurance to rehabilitation for that's a mental rehabilitation also, and long-term oxygen may be needed for her, and she will be required to give vaccinations for see that we don't get another episodes of viral sort of an episode. These are all things I think we have to consider, and revisit HRCT once a year if possible, or if there is a symptom which comes up. And of course, these parameters to monitors are not very strictly followed, but then many patients we lose because they are either not coming and the history, revisiting history is not there. And of course, possible if patient is able to walk enough, 6-minute walk test, and these are the pulmonary function tests if possible. That is also, again, a criteria which depends on patient to patient, who can hold breath, and DLCO may not be possible in many patients. So you have to, case by case, I think monitoring should also be decided on case to case basis, not general rule can be applied that they should come for six monthly or yearly HRCT or pulmonary function testing or other thing. I think history is very, very important. And probably many a time we may be able to help them by knowing that they are going to have problem by taking a good history.
Okay. Now, there was, before going to the last question, there was one question in the chat box about anti-pulmonary hypertension therapies. I think most of us will agree that secondary pulmonary hypertension is secondary to a cause. In this case, probably the patient was hypoxic for a pretty long time. And so treating the hypoxia and managing the ILD becomes a priority. Yes, adding some vasodilator might give some symptomatic relief, but I don't think that will make much difference to the prognosis of the patient. And yes, obviously, after all this talk, there's always a question or a doubt about adding antifibrotics. And theoretically, it makes sense. We toyed around with the idea of giving antifibrotics even in post-COVID fibrosis, which we know is just a one-hit fibrosis. So, Alpamam, I would like to take this last question to you. I mean, would you give antifibrotics to such a patient? Would you think there is any contribution of those drugs to this patient?
Yes. So, with the new evidence, with the impulses and senses trials, there has been good evidence of use of antifibrotics in systemic sclerosis, and it's been FDA approved now. Nintedanib. So it two ways. If a systemic sclerosis patient has ILD, which is predominantly UIP pattern, it helps by reducing the decline in FVC and kind of stabilizing the FVC and DLCO. But if patient has non-UIP pattern like fibrotic NSIP, then it does actually help in improving the FVC and DLCO. Now, having said that, actually speaking, real life scenario, we see that a lot of side effects of antifibrotics which our patients have. And already a systemic sclerosis patient with multi-system involvement, they have a lot of GI symptoms. So how many of your patients are going to tolerate the antifibrotic that you need to see? And even in both these trials, it failed to have any impact on the quality of life of the patient. So you have to take into consideration when you're giving them antifibrotic, watch for the quality of life, how they're symptomatically tolerating, if it's affecting their food intake, if it's impacting their nutrition and already increasing the muscle wasting. So having taken all these points into consideration, you should use antifibrotic.
So I think let's wrap up the panel discussion. We overshot the time. And I would just like to just say that managing every ILD requires a good clinician, a good team person, where you have to share your details with the other disciplines and take help of your rheumatologist colleagues, of your radiologist. If you've taken a biopsy, discuss with the pathologist, don't feel shy to call, give them a call and ask, what do you think? This could be a differential point to me. What is your thought process on that? And definitely don't forget the use of non-pharmacological therapies, oxygen therapy, as Dr. Sir was saying about vaccinations, becomes very important. And yes, antifibrotics, if you find a fibrotic ILD, because logically it makes sense, and we will still be awaiting more data on other fibrotic ILD. But as far as SSC ILD is concerned, we have some data which suggests that we can give some antifibrotics. So with this, I would like to thank all my panelists and for this good discussion, and Tarang for presenting the case, and Manas for giving us the kickstart now. So thank you all. Have a good evening. Have a good weekend.
I think just to announce that we will be continuing this chess forum. So next topic is going to be on severe asthma. And you all are welcome to give your suggestion, to participate, to present all the chess physicians. And thank you very much for this wonderful response. And 32 people were waiting till the end, even though we overshot the time. So thank you very much. We really enjoyed the session. I do not know about you all, but thank you. Thank you, all of you. And thank you, all my faculty members, all my colleagues. Thank you for a wonderful.
Thank you.